Paz Cristo, praise the Lord. Welcome everyone to our virtual service. We are pleased and we're blessed to be here. We've been hearing great testimonies from everyone and that God is moving in an awesome way in all of your lives, so we're thankful for that. Estamos agradecidos con el Señor, hermanos, porque hemos escuchado muchos testimonios y nosotros sabemos que el Señor es fiel y sigue haciendo grandes cosas en nuestras vidas. Hermanos, en este momento vamos a ponernos de pie y vamos a alabarle al Señor y abrir este servicio con oración, como siempre. Amén. Señor Jesucristo, tú eres bueno, tú eres fiel y tú eres, Señor, grande. No hay nadie como tú. Y ese día, Señor, es un honor, un regalo tremendo, Señor, tenemos de estar aquí en tu presencia. Estar, Señor, en nuestros hogares, alabando tu nombre, levantando las manos, levantando la voz, declarando tu grandeza, declarando tu fidelidad, Señor, porque tú eres fiel. You are so faithful. You're more than faithful, in fact. You are so good, and we thank you for all that you're doing. We pray, Lord God, that you would bless those that have, Lord, some needs, my Father, Lord, that they have spoken, and some that even they haven't spoken, some secret, Lord, needs. But we pray, Lord, for those that are going through health issues, those that are going through financial issues, those, my God, that are just needing an answered prayer. We ask you, Lord, that you lift up our joy levels, lift up, my God, our peace levels, that we would leave this service, Lord, feeling refreshed by your presence. But would we be able to give you all the honor and praise, Lord, from, Lord, an excellent place in our hearts, because you are with us and have never failed us. In the name of Jesus we pray, amen. Hermanos, en este momento vamos a levantar un canto que nosotros siempre cantamos, un canto hermoso, un clásico que dice, Gloria sea el nombre de Dios. So wonderful. At this time, we're singing a song that says Cornerstone, because the Lord God is our cornerstone. He is the one that we are built on, and he is the one that we depend on daily.
My hope is built on nothing less.
Tornado, every problem, every turbulent situation, you are God. Hermanos, el Señor está con nosotros y estamos en medio de una cosecha espiritual. Aunque en las noticias, aunque afuera ellos están hablando de puras cosas negativas, en nosotros, en esta iglesia, hay muchas cosas hermosas y tremendas que están sucediendo. Pero también vamos a seguir orando por nuestros hermanos en Cristo que están pasando de un tiempo de necesidad. Pero en este tiempo, hermanos, vamos a escuchar la palabra de Dios con nuestro pastor Leobardo Maffei. Dios les bendiga.
Hermano, paz de Cristo. En esta mañana damos la honra y la gloria a Dios por su misericordia, sus favores, su paciencia, su benevolencia, porque todavía estamos aquí alabando a Dios. Es para mí un alto privilegio dirigirme a la hermosa iglesia de Sion, que estamos pasando por un calor abrumador, ¿verdad? Y aquí en el templo está calientito, hermanos, ¿verdad? Pero aquí estamos alabando y glorificando a Dios. Antes de ir adelante, vamos a hacer una oración por los ministros Daniel Rodríguez y el hermano Jorge Baltazar. Los dos están en el hospital a esta hora y vamos a hacer una oración que Dios envíe su palabra de poder, de sanidad y que los levante, hermanos, de ese lecho del dolor, que los sane. Señor Padre Santo, en esta mañana te presentamos a tu siervo, Señor, nuestro hermano Daniel Rodríguez, nuestro hermano Jorge Baltasar, que están sufriendo. Te pedimos en el nombre de Cristo Jesús que quites esas infecciones, Señor, aleluya, que abundan en sus cuerpos. Pero para ti no era imposible, porque tu palabra dice, ¿verdad?, de que todo lo que pidiéramos en tu nombre creyendo lo recibiréis. Ellos son tus siervos, Señor. Envía tu palabra de poder y libéralos, a los libres de toda enfermedad, y glorifícate en esta transacción, en el nombre de Cristo Jesús. Amén. Hermanos, en esta mañana quiero dejarles un pensamiento y los tiempos de los que estamos viviendo no son tiempos normales, son tiempos abnormales, que parece que todo está trastornado, está cambiado. Pero nosotros, los hijos de Dios, lo que nos ayuda es de que nuestro Dios está con nosotros. Eso es lo que nos relaja, nos da paz y tranquilidad. Y la palabra de Dios nos deja el patrón que debemos de seguir. Y por eso el Salmo 91:7 dice: caerán a tu lado 1,000 y 10,000 a tu diestra, mas a ti no llegará. Mas a ti no llegará. Este año, hermanos, va a quedar marcado en la historia como un año en el cual este virus ha trastornado la vida de muchas personas. En el mundo entero se ha experimentado esta enfermedad que ha traspasado fronteras, océanos, países y hasta un continente. Muchas personas perdieron sus vidas y la economía mundial, hermanos, ha declinado. Se han perdido billones de dólares porque ciudades enteras fueron afectados, pues el comercio tuvo que ser congelado por tratar de controlar la contaminación e infección de esta enfermedad. Muchas familias están sufriendo escasez, pobreza y aún la falta de víveres, de cosas necesarias. En lo que toca a nosotros, sí nos ha afectado porque el templo sigue cerrado. No hemos tenido la libertad de venir a adorar a Dios y escuchar su palabra. En lo personal, se nos ha impuesto muchas restricciones gubernamentales, por ejemplo, de no reunirnos con personas que no son parte de nuestra familia inmediata, de no asistir a eventos públicos, de siempre traer una mascarilla facial, de no estrecharnos la mano, de no abrazarnos, de lavarnos las manos continuamente, de no tocarnos la cara, etcétera, etcétera. Y otra cosa, ¿verdad?, es que no podemos salir de nuestros hogares a menos que sea necesario, y solamente podemos ir, ¿verdad?, a comprar, ¿verdad?, los víveres, a ir al banco, a ir a la estación de gasolina, ¿verdad?, únicamente, ¿verdad?, lo que es necesario. Por otro lado, algunos de nuestros familiares y amigos han sido afectados, pero lo más drástico que sí nos ha afectado a algunos de los hermanos es que algunos no pudieron trabajar por un poco de tiempo por causa de esta pandemia. Pero en este día, hermanos, en este día podemos levantar las manos en victoria, porque el Señor no nos va a dejar, no nos va a desamparar. Tenemos la oportunidad de reflexionar y analizar todos los acontecimientos y avalar nuestras vidas, pero debemos de estar en la mejor disposición de darle gracias a Dios y regocijarnos en su misericordia. Y como diría Samuel, hasta aquí nos ayudó Jehová. Y Salmo 91:1 dice: el que habita al abrigo del Altísimo morará bajo la sombra del Omnipotente. Diría Jehová: esperanza mía, castillo mío, mi Dios en quien confiaré. Este salmo, hermanos, debe ser un salmo muy importante en nuestras vidas, porque nos habla del poder de Dios. El salmista utiliza cuatro nombres de Dios que son el Yon, Shaddai, Jehová y Elohim. El Yon significa altísimo. Este hombre nos habla de posesión. Esto nos dice que nuestro Dios es poseedor de los cielos y la tierra. Él es dueño de todo. Dios tiene un lugar de refugio en donde nosotros nos podemos esconder y recibir protección, porque lo tenemos a Él, que es el dueño de todo. Al Señor sea la honra y la gloria. También nosotros somos de Dios, hermanos. Shaddai, que significa omnipotente, este nombre nos habla de provisión. Dios no únicamente es el Dios vivo, pero también es un Dios que provee. Él es el que provee todas nuestras necesidades. Hermanos, y alabamos a Dios porque todavía, ¿verdad?, estamos viviendo. En esta mañana yo alababa a Dios porque desperté. Gracias, Señor, ¿verdad?, porque en esta mañana me diste una vez más vida. Y por eso Pablo le decía a los atenienses acerca del Dios verdadero: porque en Él vivimos, porque en Él nos movemos y por Él somos. En otras palabras, todo lo que tenemos es porque Dios nos los ha dado. ¿Qué hemos recibido de Dios? La vida, la salvación, la verdad, la salud, las fuerzas, la inteligencia, la pericia, la habilidad, el conocimiento del Dios verdadero, hermanos, y por último la vida eterna. La palabra Jehová significa el Dios de promesa. Este fue el nombre más grandioso de Dios que existió entre los hebreos. Él es el Dios que existe, porque Él le dijo, cuando le preguntaba Moisés a Jehová: bueno, ¿y cuál es tu nombre? ¿Qué le voy a decir a Faraón? ¿Cuál es tu nombre? Y Dios le dice: dile a Faraón que yo soy el que soy. Al Señor sea la honra y la gloria. Hermano, nuestro Dios, Él siempre ha sido, Él no tiene principio y no tiene fin, porque Él es el yo soy, el Dios eterno, inmutable, incambiable. Al Señor sea la honra en esta mañana. Especialmente el Dios del pacto de relación con su pueblo. Aquel pensamiento es de promesa. Él es el Dios que se ha comprometido a sí mismo para hacer cosas grandes y maravillosas para nosotros, su iglesia. Cosas que absolutamente nadie en el cielo o la tierra no le puede dar. Y absolutamente que nadie nos las puede quitar, ni el mismo infierno, hermanos, puede ser obstáculo o el diablo para que nosotros obtengamos la vida eterna. Al Señor sea la honra y la gloria. Elohim, el Dios, el Creador, este nombre nos habla de su poder. Por la fe entendemos haberse constituido el universo por la palabra de Dios, de modo que todo lo que se ve fue hecho de lo que no se veía. Hebreos 11:3. Los cielos cuentan o declaran la gloria de Dios, y el firmamento anuncia la obra de sus manos. En las noches, hermanos, cuando no hay humo, no hay smog, podemos ver el cielo y son millones, billones, trillones, hermanos, el número de estrellas, de astros, es innumerable. ¿Quién hizo todo eso? Nuestro Dios. Él es el que, hermano, nos cuida, nos protege, y eso debe darnos confianza a nosotros. Hermanos, y en este verso habla de la gloria de Dios, se usa la palabra Shabod, que significa esplendor, honor, magnificencia, autoridad, excelencia y sobre todo el poder de Dios. Gloria a Dios, aleluya. Y en la versión inglesa bíblica, King James, la palabra esperanza es traducida a refugio. Y también esta palabra en el hebreo es makesh, quien significa albergue, un lugar de confianza, y esta a la vez viene de la raíz hebraica kausha, que significa huyendo hacia la protección, confiando en, y describe la seguridad e intimidad de un lugar de albergue como lo debe ser el matrimonio. Esto nos enseña un principio muy precioso. Si nosotros hacemos de Dios nuestro refugio y nuestra habitación confiando en Él, Él se encargará de cuidarnos. Y ahí donde, hermanos, entra en acción nuestra fe. Nosotros no somos gente que andamos, hermanos, por lo que se ve. A nosotros, hermanos, en nosotros habita la fe que sobrepasa todo, esa fe, hermanos, en la cual debemos de saber, de conocer, de creer que Dios sí está con nosotros. Y yo sé que a veces llegan los problemas, las dificultades, no hallamos las puertas, hermanos, no sabemos cómo solucionar los problemas con los cuales estamos confrontando, pero debemos de llenarnos de fe que Dios es con nosotros, Él es nuestro refugio. Es lo que escribió, hermanos, el salmista, de que nosotros podamos refugiarnos en Dios. Él es nuestro refugio, Él es nuestra habitación, Él se encargará de cuidarnos. Él atenderá a nuestros temores. Él nos proveerá de una paz que excede a todo conocimiento. Más que nunca en estos momentos, en estos días, hay hermanos, familias que están pasando por cosas muy difíciles. Estos son los días en que debemos de confiar en Dios. Estamos en las manos de Dios. Él se va a encargar de cuidarnos. Yo sé que cuando pase la prueba, hermanos, vamos a mirar hacia atrás y vamos a saber que Dios estuvo con nosotros, que Dios nos protegió, que Dios nos ayudó. Hermanos, porque por nuestras propias fuerzas no podremos seguir adelante. Estamos confiando en Él, Dios Todopoderoso. Estamos confiando, hermanos, en ese Dios, ¿verdad? En ese Dios altísimo, omnipotente, Dios de promesa, Dios el Creador y el Dios Todopoderoso. Al Señor sea ahora la gloria. Hasta ahorita, hermanos, tenemos la salud, tenemos nuestros matrimonios están intactos, nuestros hijos siguen sanos. Pero lo más importante es que Dios nos ha guardado de caer en el mal, hermanos. Eso es lo más importante, que Dios nos ha cuidado, nos ha protegido, hermanos, de caer en el mal, porque Él está con nosotros. Todavía continuamos fieles en el camino del Señor hacia la vida eterna. Eso es lo que cuenta. La vida eterna. Oremos, Señor Padre Celestial. Señor, estos tiempos son tiempos muy abnormales. El mundo afuera, Señor, está lleno de temor, de angustia, aún de miedo. Y las ciudades están ardiendo por tanto,
sublevación que ha habido en contra de la autoridad. Estamos viviendo en un mundo caótico. Pero esta tarde te alabamos, Señor, porque nosotros, tu iglesia, estamos en tus manos. Bendito sea tu nombre. Estamos en tus manos. Aleluya, donde tú nos guardas, nos proteges, nos consuelas, nos ayudas. Aleluya, y sobre todo nos das la paz, la quietud, el sosiego. Aleluya, la tranquilidad. Continúa con nosotros, Señor. No nos dejes. Señor, aleluya, envía el poder, el consuelo por los que sufren. Sana a los enfermos. Señor, los que están sufriendo escasez. Señor, aleluya, envíales trabajo. Envíalos, Señor, suple sus necesidades, porque tú eres nuestro Dios proveedor y protector. Bendice cada familia de esta congregación, cada niño, cada junior, cada joven, cada dorca, cada varón, cada madre soltera, cada viuda. Bendice esta hermosa iglesia, Señor, y todo esto te lo pedimos en el nombre de Cristo Jesús. Amén. Hermanos, enseguida nuestro hermano Stephen Maffei con el mensaje en inglés. Amén.
God bless our pastor. Amen. We're going to get right into it. We are going to open our Bibles and we're going to read in 1 Chronicles in a little bit, chapter 16. Before that, we're going to pray. Lord God, I thank you so much for your word. Thank you for your blessings. I thank you for being with us today. And I pray, Lord God, this message that you've given to me, that it might be fastened to my heart always, that it might guide our lives, may guide our, Lord, the bridge that we take to you always, Lord, because you are the bridge. But this bridge, my God, has been given to us through your word, through your presence. May we worship you always in spirit and in truth. In your precious name we pray. Amen. We're going to read 1 Chronicles chapter 16, just a portion of it. And I'm taking note of the time right now. I don't want to take too long. I know that it's a little warm in here and outside, and so I'm putting the alarm on my phone right now. I'm not going to take longer than 16 minutes and 40 seconds, I promise. All right. So 1 Chronicles chapter 16, just to set the stage a little bit for what's happening here. The Bible says that David was celebrating the presence of God in the ark that they were pitching a tent for. The Bible says that David got everyone together. He gave everyone directions on how they would give sacrifices, how they would give burnt offerings and loaves of bread and cakes of dates and cakes of raisins. And every family was a part of it. Every family was a part of worship and praise. And the Bible says they worshiped and they praised God with instruments. And they had groups and they had almost an army of worshipers praising and worshiping God. And just to read you a portion of what David said that day, he said in verse 23, "Sing to the Lord all the earth, proclaim his salvation day after day, declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous deeds among all the people. For great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. He is to be feared above all gods, for all the gods of the nations are idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Splendor and majesty are before him. Strength and joy are in his dwelling place. Ascribe to the Lord all you families of nations. Ascribe the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come before him. Worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness." So David was worshiping God. He was worshiping the Lord, and he gave it all he had. He was doing it with everything that he had. And in the traditions of the Word of God, we understand that God is a God that desires to be connected with his people. Worship is a way that we connect to God. Worship is a way that we draw close to God. That is the method. That is the thing that God wants us to use to get close to him.
Our God is good. Our God is loving. He is caring. And the details matter to God. The little things matter to God. The way we worship, the way we come before Him, it matters to God. It all matters. This is why He has designed us so carefully. He designed us with His loving hands and with the breath of His essence. He gave us life. And even after Adam and Eve sinned, He did not do away with them without mercy. But even after they sinned, He gave them directions on how they should have a relationship with Him. God could have wiped them out because of their sin and wicked ways, but He didn't. But God, being love and just and true and light and life and the way, He being so good and so awesome, He still was more than faithful when He allowed them to live. Because God doesn't really owe us anything, does He? God doesn't get a bill in the mail from us. God doesn't have to pay us anything, but He did give His life for us either way. Even though He didn't deserve to do it, even though He didn't need to give His life, He gave His life for us. And God today desires for us to know Him and to love Him and trust Him in Him. And when we look early in the history of man, the history of the righteous, we see that God has always wanted to have a relationship with His people. In Genesis, we see how He walked in the garden and spoke to Adam and Eve. And we see that when He freed Israel from Egypt, He gave Moses instructions on how they should honor Him. He was very specific. And we have a record of what He asked for in those books. There were different types of sacrifices. There were atonement rituals, free will and thanksgiving offerings. His instructions, again, were detailed. Just the way that we like our food a certain way. We like things a certain way. I like my bacon very crispy. Some people don't like their bacon crispy. They like it soggy. I don't know how they do that. Some people like their eggs sunny side up and a little bit of running, right? I don't like it to run. I like it to all be there in one spot. So we care about the details, but we should understand that God cares about the details too. And so these people, the Israelites and the righteous, have always had a roadmap of how to worship God. The Lord, our God, has always given us a method to worship Him. God has never been a God that is ambiguous. God has never sent us double messages. God is very direct. God is very clear. God is very concise with His language. And what He asked for, we should be careful in giving to Him. God wants what He wants. He is clear. And He asked for our sincerity. And He wants an exclusive relationship with us. God doesn't want us to be casual in the way we serve Him. But He wants us to serve Him with honor, respect, sincerity, and with all that we have. He wants us to see Him as our prize. And He wants to be our only God. He wants us to worship Him with honor and with gratitude in our hearts. And that's why the psalmist said that when we come before His presence, we should come with thanksgiving ready in our hearts. We should come with something ready to give to God. It's not accidental, but it's something very deliberate. It's planned. It's something that we should come with an intention to do. We should come with an attitude of gratitude and gladness, an attitude of joy and thanksgiving, and saying, God, You are good and You are wonderful. What's in our sacrifice today that we're giving God? What is in our sacrifice? Sacrifice is a question I'm asking you today. So the pattern of the righteous is in the way they worship God. It always has been. Noah built altars to God. Abraham built altars of God. David, when he felt like he was dying of thirst, and his troops went across in the enemy lines, and they brought him back water because he felt that he was unworthy of such a sacrifice and gift. The Bible says that he poured it out before God as a sacrifice of worship. What a wonderful thing it is when a person knows that they need to give God something better. Do we serve an awesome God? Do we serve a powerful God? Do we serve a loving God? Of course we do. So we should come with a worship. We should come with a sacrifice that is deep and is expensive, and something that is from the deepest part of our hearts and our souls. The pattern of the righteous, again, is the way they worship. We don't know the specifics of it. We don't know when it was given. But we know that Adam and Eve were given instructions on how to worship God. We know because Abel shows us. The account is given about these two brothers. And Pastor John MacArthur wrote, it's true. They may have been twins because it introduces one after the other. We know one was younger. We know one was older, by a little bit at least. We know that one worked the fields and the crops, and the other one worked the herds. But the biggest difference was their approach to worship. And I want to see if you can turn with me to Genesis chapter 4, verses 3 through 5. Genesis 4, 3 through 5. In the course of time, Cain brought to the Lord an offering of the fruit of the ground, and Abel who also brought of the firstborn of his flock and of their fat portions. See what Abel was bringing? He was bringing a part of his herd, a part of the livestock that he had that was healthy and young and also fat. It was a good size. The Lord had regard. He accepted. He honored Abel for his offering, but for Cain and his offering, he had no regard. He didn't accept it. So Cain was angry and his face fell, meaning his attitude became one of anger. And so we look at this closer and we see some things that we can pull out from the scripture. To Abel, bringing a sacrifice to God was an honor. To Cain, going before God in sacrifice was a chore. To Abel, bringing a sacrifice was a blessing. To Cain, bringing a sacrifice was a bore. To Abel, bringing a sacrifice to God was heartfelt. To Cain, it was an obligation. To Abel, coming before God was seeking righteousness and seeking the heart and the face of God. To Cain, it was nothing but a ritual. To Abel, this was worship. To Cain, this was whatever. We've come to a point in time where many people use the word whatever to mean something that they feel indifferent to. When you don't want to think about something, when you don't want to do something, you say whatever. But I think that the trap and the challenge and the problem is when that attitude begins to seek in to the house of worship and to the worship lifestyle that we have. It's okay to be whatever about your choice of dinner. It's okay to be whatever about what shoes you put on that day. But it's not okay to say whatever when it comes to worship. When it comes to worship, it's got to be something good. It's got to be something from your heart. It's got to be something that you put some sweat and tears into. You've got to lift up your hands sometimes. You've got to shout to God sometimes. You've got to worship Him in spirit and in truth, because our God is a good God and He's worthy of all the praise, honor, and glory. Our God is good, and we need to do our worship with that type of attitude like Abel did. God had expected a certain quality of sacrifice, and only Abel followed His direction. He knew that there was an important element to sacrifice and to worship. He knew this, and this is powerful. True worship, a true sacrifice, has to cost you something. True worship and a true sacrifice has to cost you something. So that's why He brought that young, beautiful animal, and He slayed it before God. It was a healthy, thick lamb, and He knew that only the blood was good enough. Isn't that something that speaks to our heart? Only the blood is good enough for you and I. Only the blood can wash us. Only the love can justify us. Only the blood can set us free. Only the blood can bring us salvation. Only blood. Jesus, His blood cost Him something. And that's why we are saved. So it's only right that the worship we give to Him costs us something. Sometimes worship has to be a little uncomfortable. Sometimes when you worship God, you've got to shake yourself out of sleep. You've got to lift up your hands, hallelujah, wherever you are. You have to bow before your knees. You have to focus on Him. You've got to put every other thought aside and begin to bless God and say, you are good, you are faithful, you are true, you are holy, you are perfect. There is no one like you. You are Alpha and Omega, beginning and the end, the Lion of Judah, the coming King, my high and risen Savior. There is no one like you. Worship Him, worship Him, worship Him, and it's going to cost you something. It's going to cost you fasting sometimes. It's going to cost you getting into the Word. It's going to cost you turning off the TV sometimes. It's going to cost you relationships. It might cost you a job or opportunities, but worship, true worship, is going to cost you something. We have to be okay with being uncomfortable. We have to be okay being a little weird and peculiar sometimes. We have to be okay with giving God the best that we have, even if it's a little uncomfortable or painful at times, because He's worthy. So while Abel brought the Lord a filet mignon, Abel brought the Lord some sour apples. Worship is one of the greatest privileges we have, but Cain treated it with indifference. After he was rejected, the Lord lovingly sought him out and warned him. In verse 7 of Genesis chapter 4, he says, "If you do well, will you not be accepted?" He's saying, if you repent and you believe in me, you worship me, don't you know that I will accept you? Don't you know, he's talking to us today, don't you know that I'll accept you? If you come and believe in my name, you worship me, I'll accept you. But if you do not do well, sin is crouching at the door. Look at the way God describes sin. God describes sin as it's something active and conscious. I can't get to the bottom of it, but I know that it's got meaning for us today. If you do not do well, sin is waiting. It's crouching at your door, and its desire is contrary to you. It's to overcome you. It's to take you over, but you must rule it. The Lord told him that sin followed an unappreciative and a proud heart. And what happens is when you neglect your privilege of worship, that's when your heart gets weighed down by this world and by sin. That's when pride takes over. And sin and death are not far behind a proud and unbelieving, unrepentant heart. And that's exactly what happened. Cain's negative and proud heart anchored him down. He became jealous of his brother instead of realizing his own mistakes. How many of you guys know that sometimes the easiest thing for us to do is to look at someone else's flaw instead of looking at ourselves? Oh my God, how many times have we been there? Lord, but how come he, how come they? And God's like, son, won't you take a look at yourself right now? Won't you humble yourself first? And sometimes that's hard, but we have to be humble when we come before God. Cain couldn't do that. He killed his brother because he could not repent of his sin. He didn't take worship seriously. He lied to God. And one sad thing is that we never see any evidence of him repenting. We never see any evidence of him saying, God, I'm sorry, I want to be right with you. And the Bible says that he was sent away marked for life because of his sin. Abel's story, however, continues. The Bible says, Paul says, that when he's speaking of living by faith and he's speaking about the spiritual world, the spiritual reality of life, he says, by faith, Abel still speaks. That means he walked in righteousness here, and now he's up there walking with the Lord forever. You and I have eternity to look forward to. When we worship God in spirit and in truth, we don't have to worry about today or tomorrow, because we walk forever. We walk forever by faith. We will walk forever when we worship God in spirit and in truth. Our story continues on forever and ever. He lives in the presence of God. Those that worship in spirit and truth will live forever. And there's something that I learned from this word, is that worship isn't something that we can just skate on by with. Worship isn't something that we can just go on auto mode with it with, or cruise control. But worship is something that we have to do deliberately and do with all of our heart and all of our mind and all of our soul.
And before I finish, I just want to finish with this. There's a lot of things that we don't control in this world. There's a lot of things that might go wrong. And there's a lot of things that you can point to about your life and situation that's negative. But there's one thing that you can choose. You choose your attitude. You choose what you value. You choose how you will proceed. Don't allow the negativity of the world. Don't allow the bad news that is on the internet and on the TV to shift your attention away from God. Instead, allow these things to push you closer to God so that you can just give all of your burdens to God, so that you can just worship Him with all that you have. You can just thank Him for all the good things He's done, because our God is faithful, our God is good, and everything that's going on in your life at some point is going to give you even more purpose. It's going to make you stronger. God's going to give you victory in His season, in His time. Don't you know that God is working it out? God is working it out. All you got to do is worship right now while you wait for the answered prayer. Don't allow Satan, don't allow the world to mess with your quality of worship. What is in your worship today? What is in your worship today? What are you bringing to God? Approach Him today with gladness, with humility, with a repentant heart. Let's pray. Lord God, we come before You and we thank You for this honor and privilege of being here today. And I pray, Lord, You give us, my God, an attitude of humility and hunger and thirst when we worship You. May we not, Lord, take this privilege lightly. May we worship You, Lord God, with all of our heart. May we pour out, Lord, our worship like the perfume that Mary did upon Your feet. May we pour out this worship as David did, my God. May we pour out this worship, my God, hallelujah, as Hannah did, Lord Jesus, as she opened and poured out her heart. May we worship You, Lord God, every single day. And may we thank You for all that You've done and all that You are. And may we, Lord God, serve You with gladness, not, Lord, out of obligation, not out of ritual, not out of anything, Lord, that's casual or indifferent, but may we worship You for who You are and what You've done. Well, we praise You. In Your name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Now with us, Brother Leo Maffei, our assistant pastor. God bless you.
Amen. We praise God and give God honor and glory. Damos gracias a nuestro Rey Cristo Jesús, hermanos, por su palabra de parte de nuestro pastor y de parte del hermano ministro Esteban Maffei. We thank God because God, He continues to speak because He is awesome. He never stops being God. Él nunca para de ser Dios. Y una de las cosas que yo estaba pensando durante este tiempo de alabanza y de palabra de Dios, one of the things that I was thinking about when I was hearing God's word es cuando Pedro salió de ese barco y empezó de caminar hacia Dios, hacia Cristo Jesús. When Peter stepped out of that boat and he began to walk towards Jesus. Well, that ocean, that water that was beneath his feet is the chaos. Ese agua del mar es el caos. And there's chaos. And we've heard it twice today. There's chaos. There's uncertainty. Things are not normal. No estamos viviendo en tiempos, como dijo el pastor, normales. Hay un caos. Pero cuando nosotros pongámonos nuestros ojos en Cristo, when we put our eyes on Christ, He gives us the strength. Él nos da la fortaleza para caminar sobre el mar de caos. To walk over a sea of chaos. And the way that we are able to do that is by connecting with our God. Es conectando con el Señor. Por eso la salmista dice, busqué a Jehová y Él me oyó y me libró de todos mis temores. The psalmist writes, King David actually, he says, I sought the Lord and He heard me and He delivered me from all my fears. Now, hallelujah, be more than ever before, God is calling His church to seek Him. Más que nunca antes, el Señor nos está llamando para que nosotros busquemos la presencia de Dios. Entonces, mañana es día de descanso por muchos. No habrá oración en la hora de las 7 p.m., pero sí, Vamos a escoger una hora, sea en la mañana, mediodía o en la tarde o tres veces y orar, dedicar una hora delante del Señor, hermanos. Vamos a escoger también un día esta semana para dar una ofrenda de ayuno y oración. We're going to fast one day, at least one day this week before Jesus, to give him praise, to give him honor, and for all of the needs. Vamos a seguir orando, hermanos, por todos que están enfermos y necesidad, Ministro Rodríguez, Ministro Baltasar, y muchos más. También, hermanos, queremos dar gracias a Dios por todos ustedes que están dando a la obra de Dios, como dice la palabra de Dios, de voluntad de corazón, con gozo, con agradecimiento. Vamos a dar gracias a Dios por todos ustedes. Aleluya, porque hay grande necesidad, pero todo es de Él. Nos servimos a un Dios fiel. Aleluya, Él está con nosotros. Él nunca nos ha dejado solos. Aleluya, y nosotros sabemos que tenemos victoria en el poderoso nombre de Cristo Jesús. We are thankful for all of you that are giving out of the gratitude of your heart, that you are worshiping God. What a beautiful privilege. Qué grande privilegio que el Señor nos ha dado a nosotros participar en el reino de Dios, poder dar, hermanos, diezmos y ofrendas. We are able to participate in His kingdom by giving our tithes and offerings. But we want to encourage you. Queremos, hermanos, exhortar a cada uno de ustedes. Vamos a seguir adelante. Vamos a seguir adelante. Vamos a seguir marchando adelante. We're going to keep on marching forward in the beautiful and powerful name of Jesus. I want to invite you to pray. Can we pray? Can we dismiss from this virtual service? And God is not limited by anything, by space or time. And so we want to just lift His name right now. Queremos levantar el nombre de Cristo Jesús en oración. Con las manos levantadas, si están sentados, hermanos, voy a pedir que se levanten esta mañana. Lift up, hallelujah, let's stand up right now. Let's lift up our hands, Lord Jesus. Cristo Jesús, te adoramos, Señor. Oh, tú eres el Dios Todopoderoso. Jesus, you are the all-powerful God. Te damos, Señor, a ti toda la alabanza. Te exaltamos, aleluya, a tu nombre. Te damos gracias, Señor, porque tú estás con nosotros. Para siempre es tu misericordia. Your mercy endures, oh Lord, for all time and forever. And we are thankful because of the things that you are doing in your church. Te damos gracias por los milagros, porque estás moviendo en maneras poderosas en tu iglesia, Señor. Presentamos las necesidades. We present the needs of our brethren, los que están enfermos, los que, aleluya, están decaídos, los que necesitan trabajo, Señor, que tú eres el Jehová Jireh. Tú eres el Señor que nos provee. You are the God that provides strength. You are the God that provides bread of life. You are the God that provides water that takes away our thirst. You are the God of abundance. Tú eres el Señor de abundancia. Oh, Señor, y te damos gracias y alabanza. Aleluya, dedicamos, Señor, este tiempo. Dedicamos, Señor, este ministerio. Dedicamos, Señor, a cada familia, a tu iglesia, Señor, delante de tus pies. In the powerful name of Jesus we pray. En el nombre de Cristo Jesús. Amen, amen, amen. God bless you, church. Iglesia, Dios le bendiga. Amen.